Letterman's first said. And the most important thing I said to them was, listen, you got to do something here that's going to just blow people the fuck away. And this is your chance. You don't get that many chances. A lot of people haven't done it. He goes on, has by far one of the greatest sets on Letterman or any late night talk show that I've ever seen in my entire career. After the show, Rob Burnett brings him up to the office where Dave is and says, listen, we want to develop a show to you. This is how I feel. I'm 6 degrees of separation. For, by the way, everybody loves Raymond, and I'm going to show you how weird things and fate can happen in the business.
Or how you take credit for weird things.
How I take credit for weird things. I hope it didn't sound like I'm taking credit for it. But anyway,
let me. You sound like Little Richard. I invented the Beatles. Shut up. Woo! Good God, I missed the Rolling Stones. I am the Rolling Stone. Barry Katz. Everything was stolen from me. Raymond, everybody loves Barry. I let him have Raymond. I said, I don't need no Raymond. Let everybody love Raymond because I'm Barry. Oh, I'm bam, boom. Woo. Barry Seinfeld. I changed my last name so there was no breach of contract. Woo. I would have to say X gets the square.
I'd say for the record.
Turn it to Jack Hay at the end. Sorry.
Ooh, Mary.
For the record, I did say 6 degrees of separation.
I know.
So
I
this
just
is how.
See if I had a Little Richard impression.
You do. It's wonderful.
I have the words. The impression sounded like Jack Hay.
Ooh, I invented rock and roll, baby. Ooh. Ooh. I'm boo.
I can't do no more. Oh, that's Sobel.
I can't do no more.
Oh, that's another story, Barry Sobel. Anyway, so Jeff Ross gets called up.
Don't
to the
tease him like that, Katz.
Office. We'll get to Barry Sobel later. Gets up to the office and they say, "We want to develop a show with you. We want to make a deal with you to do a scripted show around your comedy for CBS." The greatest moment of any comedian's life. You go on, you destroy immediate gratification. That. I get back from Letterman. Apparently, the live feed happens in the live feed happens in L.A. So at the time that it's happening, like at 4 or 5 o'clock. So I get back to my office, which was right around the corner. I'm just as high as a kite. I get a call from Glenn Padnick, who is the president of Castle Rock Entertainment. He's just seen Letterman on the live feed. At the time, they have Seinfeld on the air, number one show in America. He says, Barry, I just saw the feed. I want to do a deal with Jeff Ross for his own show. Okay? I'm like, this is unbelievable. I don't know what to do. I tell Jeff. The next day, I do what I think is best. I talk to Jeff about everything. At the time, I get a call from Les Moonves. It's his first week on the job at CBS as the president of CBS. The first week or month. I said, hi, Les, haven't talked to you in a while. I said, Barry, I just want to tell you something. I've already heard from Glenn Padnick at Castle Rock, and I've heard from Dave at Worldwide Pants, and I'm just telling you this. I don't care who you do the show with. I want it at CBS. I say, wow, that's an honor. Okay, I'll let Jeff know that. The next day, we're talking all through the next day, deciding, because you got to decide besides Castle Rock, the number one show in America with Seinfeld, or Worldwide Pants, who's never done a television show, a scripted television show before.
And then complicating matters, that afternoon you got a call from Anwar Sadat.
Yes, that's right.
He said, I want a piece of Jeff Ross.
So that next morning, we both get Letterman jackets in the mail and a note from CBS.
Ooh,
and
nice touch. Very nice.
And
David Letterman jackets. It's not like you're on the fucking track team.
Yes,
at
David Letterman jackets. And so
walking
then
around like T-Birds.
So then Jeff is going back and forth. He's trying to figure out what to do. He feels bad because he did Letterman, and if he goes with that company, but they've never done anything before, versus the company that has the number one show and is doing it. He decides to go with Castle Rock. The money was the same. It was like I think it was like a $175,000 deal at the time. Decides to go with Castle Rock.
I must interrupt now for the listeners.
Yeah.
Isn't it fascinating? And I'm sure everyone listening, Jeff Ross has the greatest set in a decade of Letterman in a lot of people's eyes. The president, the number one person at Castle Rock Entertainment, calls his manager simultaneously as the feed is happening. I must have this person. Worldwide Pants brings him upstairs in Letterman's office and says, he's not leaving this building until we have a goddamn deal. He's the most talented son of a bitch we've ever seen. Les Moonves, the president of CBS Television, says, I don't give a shit where he goes. That show's going to be on my network. Now, I know everyone listening just did a what the fuck when you said $175,000. That is the biggest misconception, is that we're all just rolling around, just trucking millions. Like, every time I see, like, other comics, like Nick DiPaolo, go, what's easy for you to say? I'm fucking $10 million in the bank. I'm like, really? $10 million? I just played a fucking casino in Reno. I fucking took the Southwest Raider bus up to Reno to make my fucking whatever G's. Here's a guy wanted by three conglomerates, and they fucking hash out the magnanimous deal of under $200,000. What would have happened if he was almost as good as that?
Well, I'll tell you.
What happened to the fucking old days? Like, you do one to the Collins, or no, Patrice said it. Like, I always thought it was like the old days. You do a Carson, you kill, and they just call you and you get a $1 million deal.
Well, you didn't back then, and that's a misconception.
You sure? You don't get zero now.
And back then, 15 years ago when this happened, I believe it was, the gold standard for a comedian development deal, the highest you could ever get was like 150.
Yeah.
So now there was one person who got the biggest deal of any comedian at that time, which was well exceeding everything, and that was John DiResta, because he had a one-person show, again, that he wrote, created, produced, and starred in with his own money.
You're basically saying, just do it by Nike. There's no truer words to go out and fucking do it.
Yeah, John got a $650,000 deal at the time when no one was getting 150.
His guts suddenly.
And what he got, how he got it, was a 13 episode guarantee at his fee of what it was, 40 or 50,000 at the time, and they guaranteed the money regardless if it went or not, and that's how that happened.
And that show was called DiResta.
DiResta.
He played a cop, which he was in real life.
That's correct.
And the New York Post reviewed his show. And with his $650,000 holding deal and $40,000 a week, so you're looking at potentially $2 million first year in your pocket after taxes, 1.8 after it's all hashed out and he writes everything off.
I think he had a partner in the show that he had.
He's looking at $2 million for this. And the New York Post, out of all the shows they decided to review, because they don't review... Like, when I'm at Caroline's, they never give a shit. When I'm at Gotham, because I don't really play Caroline's anymore, but when I go do Gotham in New York, they don't come out. I'm always like, why don't they review comics? There's no review of Gary Unmarried in the New York Times that maybe could have given it a little push for the network and helped the numbers. Someone at the Post just says, hey, I just looked at my TiVo, and I saw there's a new show called DiResta. You know what I'm going to do? What? Are you going to write about Mary Tyler Moore's 70th birthday? No, I'm going to watch this show at random, and I'm going to end a man's life. The headline for the New York Post, known for its very clever headless body and topless bar, F. Lee Jaley, Dr. No, and Doc Goodnet is no hitter. Wacko Jacko on his backo, Laffy, Gaddafi, no Laffy. The freaking headline for the John DiResta show in Dewey Defeats Truman font said, DiResta, this show stinks. And then it was a full fucking page of how it stunk, the clothing stunk, the color of the fucking refrigerator stunk. I would love to know who that asshole was.
I remember that because I remember that I think one of the same reviewers did something on Margaret Cho's show.
American Hurl.
All American Hurl.
American Hurl.
No, All American Hurl.
All American
Hurl. And the show is All American Girl. But I think that's something if you write
down. One of those two people have proven to be an incredible comic.
Well, let's not get into that. A lot of people think that one of those people is an incredible comic.
I think you're thinking reverse of what you think I'm thinking.
Well, it doesn't matter. I'm not going to say anything.
All right.
So I like both of them very much.
So John DiResta.
So another example of you write your own thing, you create your own thing, you go. Same with Margaret there. But let's go back to Jeff Ross. Okay. So he decides he's going to go with Castle Rock and
Home of Seinfeld.
Home of Seinfeld. Very disappointing for Worldwide Pants. So the very next comedian who goes on the Letterman show is Ray Romano. Ray Romano goes on. His first set on Letterman does a great job.
Oh, God. What's going on out here? I'm killing.
They bring him up to the office. They offer him a deal with CBS for his own show.
But here's the real question. Who is the third guy?
I don't know what the third guy is.
Now I got your mind going like, well, maybe they were just like, we need to get in the comedian business. The third guy was like, Tracy.
I don't know. But I do know this without divulging financial terms. The terms for Ray Romano were way, way less than Jeff Ross.
Less than the 175.
Way less.
Because they were like, we got burned, so why put up that much money
up front?
Right. Now, this
now
is...
It goes, no, but let me just keep
okay,
going.
Go ahead.
And it goes to show you...
All my interruptions this time are because it's an actual conversation,
yeah,
at least.
That it doesn't matter what money you make up front. It doesn't matter as long as you're doing something that's great that people want to watch. And so... Ray was fortunate enough to meet Phil Rosenthal, who also, I believe, had twins and had a similar lifestyle. And Ray was not...
Bi-curious.
And Ray was not given the created by credit on that show. Phil denied him the credit.
Based on the stand-up comedy,
it was only
Ray
based
Romano.
On the story of, which is a big contention for comedians, that you want to create your own show because there's a royalty involved. It's a lot of money.
Yes.
In the end, though, it didn't matter for Ray because he got his revenge later on when he got $40 million a season or something like that, that it was reported. So, but the bottom line is, another comedian passes on something, and another one comes in that wouldn't have been there, and then... The rest is history. So that can happen a lot.
Was it Louis' show, Worldwide Pants? CK?
I don't believe so. No.
First one on HBO? No. No. I thought Louis was working with.
Show with Worldwide Pants with Jim Gaffigan called Welcome to New York, and that was the first one that I know of that got on the air with a comedian. There was the one about the bowling alley guy. I love that show that with something. Oh, shoot, I forget.
You could tell.
I can't believe I'm going blank on this now.
People in a garage going,
It doesn't matter, but the Gaffigan was the first.
All right, I know it. Worldwide Pants did the bowling scene from The Big Lebowski. When John Travolta said, you fuck with the Jesus? You pull any shit like that with me? Liam and me?
It
we
was
fuck
some,
you up, man.
It was something Ed. Was the show called Ed?
Yeah. Ed TV?
No, it was Ed. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, it was great. Great
Ed?
Show. Anyway, so that's just an example, again, when you can do a great set, you have choices, but then the choices don't always work out for you, but at least you've done it and you've gotten to the point where you're noticed as a comic, and I think that's the most important thing. And for you, what's interesting about your career, if you don't mind me talking about you for a second.
That's my favorite subject.
and I'm going to, say some things, you'll probably kick me under the table. You're a different kind of guy. I don't even know a situation where I've ever seen you write a script for yourself. You've never written a movie for yourself. You've never written a half hour of comedy for yourself. I don't think.
Whoa, you don't mean stand up.
I'm talking about like a scripted show for yourself.
People listening be like, I knew he stole his act.
No. Most young artists they're writing, they're doing. You never did that. You were always like, listen. Find somebody who I can do it with, who I don't have to sit down there by the computer and do it myself, and I'll make magic. But you never were the kind of person that wanted to do that. And you're a rarity because very few comedians make it these days without writing.
Well, I've written books.
I know you've written books. I'm talking about writing scripted material.
Right. I don't know how.
Yeah, well, it's like a fear that a lot of comics have, that they get down with final draft and try to do it and make it work. And
it's like when you get a new phone or a new computer, you put it off because you're like, then I got to fucking learn Microsoft Word,
yeah, and because
Excel.
And because you've been doing it your way for so long, like getting you to do a podcast was like literally like you had to be a dentist to get you to do a podcast because you wanted to do it. You kept saying you wanted to do it. You were like, fuck, I want to get this podcast this week or do it. But when it came down to it, you had to do it on your own time, on your own terms. And when you started doing it, you realized what an inspiration it's been
Margaret
for so many
Thatcher
people.
Margaret Thatcher once explained the United States of America and me in the same sentence. They always do the right thing once they've exhausted every other option. I say that to my wife often, like, why'd you do it? I'll do the right thing. Just let me exhaust every other option first.
Yeah, so you're the kind of guy in your career, and I've always found this, is that I'm going to go on a limb here. Your career is based on those moments, those incredible holy shit moments where you've been given an opportunity to do something, and you carry things in a way that people are, it exceeds the expectation.